I was demobbed in November 47, and I'd been 3 years in a hot climate, and I came back to England, and it was the worst winter we'd had for 15 years, and the whole of England was icebound, and the only clothes I had were my demob clothes, my Burton's 50 shilling suit, and a waterproof coat. And what to do now? I wanted to be a watch repairer, and I knew I didn't have really enough experience. But in Edgware in North London, I had one. I'd been on leave and looking for tools and information, met a man who was himself just demobbed from the army, and he ran the watch repair side of the jewellers in Edgware. And I'd spoken to him, and he'd seen my watch, and he asked me who made the glass for it. It was a very complex glass, which I'd made from Perspex. I mean, when you're in the desert, you know, you can spend months just shaping a bit of plastic for it. You've got nothing else to do. And so I did all that and made various bits for the watch, and he was very impressed. And I spoke, having read de Carle, I spoke with great authority about how certain things were done. And he suggested I came back to see him when I came out, and so I did. And he gave me a job, and I'd never been so lucky in my life to get that job. And it was £3 a week. Yeah. And my digs, my accommodation, were £2.50 a week, so there was 50 pence left over to live on after I'd paid my digs. And so I was forever scrabbling around trying to make enough money to live on, get a watch and repair it and sell it, because watches were in very short supply. Weren't allowed to import them. They were hard to obtain. And there didn't seem to be very many good watchmakers about to repair them. So one way or another, that was all very helpful to me. And so I became a trade watch repairer. It never occurred to me that that was not what I should be aiming for. I was very lucky to be in work and working at what I liked, and I really enjoyed that, and I knew I was working at what I liked, so I was prepared to go into quite a lot of trouble. But the money was totally inadequate, and so I had joined up with the Northampton Polytechnic evening classes, and there met a man who said his employer was looking for a watchmaker. So instantly in my mind I became a very advanced, superior watchmaker. And I would go along to be interviewed, and I'd bought a lot of tools. In fact, when this man interviewed me, I discovered I got more tools than he had. I mean, I got lathes and everything. And so he was very impressed by that. Mm. And he very foolishly let me know how impressed he was because I had all this equipment. And so when it came to negotiating the salary, I pointed out that, you know, the £8 a week I was earning at the moment was really somewhat inadequate, and I really ought to do something about it, and that's the reason I'm prepared to change my situation. And he said to me, well, all right then, £9 a week. I was so staggered I couldn't think of an answer. And he thinking that I was delaying and wanting, said, well, all right then, and another 10 shillings travelling expenses. So of course I had to agree. And so suddenly I went into the millionaire bracket, and I could buy clothes. I mean, I had holes in my shoes, and I could buy clothes and a motorbike so that I could move about more freely. And I'd go up to Northampton Polytechnic every day on the motorbike, and then motorcycle on to Edgware, where I was in digs, and that is 25 miles between Croydon, where I worked, and Edgware, where I lived, and I'd have to do that every day, starting at 5:30 in the morning from Edgware to Croydon, get there at 7, and then in the evening up to evening classes, not home then till 11,